Hello everyone, welcome back to lecture series on aerospace propulsion. So in the previous lecture we were discussing about the ideal cycle analysis of a turbojet engine. Okay, so in that we have seen for the given different design parameters and design limiting parameters and flight parameters, how we can calculate the flow properties at the end of each and every station of our gas turbine component, and ultimately how we can calculate what is the exit velocity produced by that particular gas turbine engine. So as long as we know the exit velocity, we can find out what is the thrust generated by that particular gas turbine engine. That is, we have taken a turbojet engine. Okay. So once we get the thrust, we can calculate the performance parameters like propulsion efficiency, thermal efficiency, overall efficiency, and thrust specific fuel consumption. Okay. So what we are going to do in this today's lecture is that we are going to discuss about the ideal cycle analysis of a turbofan engine. So instead of turbojet, we are going to do the turbofan engine. Okay. The process and the procedure is going to be kind of same only, except at few components, all of the remaining process of your turbojet and turbofan ideal cycle analysis is same. Okay. So before starting our cycle analysis, let us just first see the reason for the turbofan being used in the most of our commercial aircraft. Okay. And how do they differ from the turbojet engine? Okay. So as you know, from the definition of our propulsion efficiency, okay, we have simplified this equation like we already derived in the previous lecture. So the propulsion efficiency in terms of our velocity, we have neta p is equal to 2 u by ue plus u. I can write this equation as neta p is equal to 2u by ue divided by 1 plus u by ue. Okay, so I can write this, that is, by just by taking out ue as common, I'm just going to take it to the numerator. So we'll have 2u by ue divided by 1 plus u by ue. So from this equation, you can see that when we will have the maximum propulsion efficiency, if u is equal to ue. So what do we get? If I'm going to substitute u is equal to ue, I'll have 2 divided by 1 plus 1, which is basically 1. So we'll have 100% efficiency if the flight speed and the exit flow velocity, both of them are having same speed. Okay. So meaning is that if the difference between your flight speed and your exit velocity is getting more and more, the propulsion efficiency of the particular engine will be keep on decreasing. Okay. So this also one of the reason why your turboprop is having better propulsion efficiency compared to that of your turbojet, turbofan and turbofan. Okay. Reason is because in the turboprop, what we do, we accelerate a huge amount of mass flow rate to less velocity. So in this, the majorly thrust will be contributed by the mass flow rate of air rather than the velocity difference created by this fan. Okay. So this way we'll have the maximum propulsion efficiency for our turboprop. Okay. If I'm going to take a turbojet engine, what we do is that the main thrust contribution is mainly due to the difference between exit velocity minus flight speed. So in a turbojet, the difference is going to be very, very huge. Meaning is that the propulsion efficiency of your turbojet engine is very less compared to that of your turboprop. So now what we do is that we introduce a fan in front of, a very huge fan in front of our turbojet. By introducing that, this fan will rotate. Okay, but basically it's a ducted fan which will be kept inside your intake. When it is rotated, it is going to suck in huge amount of mass flow rate of air and it will accelerate to less velocity. So this way, what we will have is that we will have an increased mass flow rate. At the same time, the velocity difference is also will be less. So how does your turbofan is actually having better propulsion efficiency than your turbojet is that? Basically, you could say your turbofan is a combination of your turbojet and turboprop. Okay, which is having propulsion efficiency in between your turboprop and turbojet. That is also, that is the reason why most of our commercial aircraft nowadays utilizes the turbofan engine. Okay, because your turboprop is having speed limitation, which can have better efficiency up to Mach number 0.6 only. If you go beyond Mach number 0.6, you will have reduced efficiency. Okay, so in order to increase the cruise speed of our commercial aircraft, we go with the turbofan. Okay, even though its propulsion efficiency less than your turboprop, it is still better than your turbo jet engine. Okay, now we are go first before starting the analysis. Let us go through the what type of turbofan engine I am going to take for our cycle analysis. Okay, and what is the station numbers? Okay, the type of turbofan engine I am going to take for this particular analysis is an unmixed twin spool turbofan engine. Okay, so now there is a two terms introduced here, an unmixed and twin spool. So what is the meaning of unmixed and what is the meaning of twin spool? So let us start with what is your unmixed turbofan engine. So what is the meaning of unmixed turbofan engine is that the flow from your cold flow, that is secondary flow and primary flow, if they have mixed together and if they are expanded through a common nozzle, they what we call it as the mixed turbofan engine. Okay, instead of that, the flow from your bypass will be accelerated as it is. The flow from your core engine will be accelerated as it is without mixing, means what we call it as the unmixed turbofan engine. So for our analysis in this case, what I am going to take is that unmixed turbofan engine. Okay, and a twin spool. What is the meaning of a spool engines, or whether it is a twin spool, three spool or four spool is there? That is basically depends on how many number of shafts we are having, that is how many number of concentric shafts we are having. Okay, so here in this turbofan engine, we are going to have two concentric shafts. Okay, so one center shaft will be connecting high pressure compressor to the high pressure turbine. Okay, and that is center shaft will connect your compressor to the high pressure turbine. Okay, the surrounding shaft will connect the low pressure turbine and your fan. So basically your compressor is rotated by the high pressure turbine and your fan is rotated by the low pressure turbine. Okay, so what is the station number here is that A21 is same as that of your turbojet engine. Basically it is external acceleration or deceleration. The process is going to be isentropic. Okay, next one is 1-2-2-. Okay, so 1-2-2-- is the intake of our turbofan engine. Okay, after 2-, what we have? Fan. So 2-2-3- is the isentropy. What is happening across your 1-2-2-? Basically, it is deceleration of your incoming flow. So the process, we are going to assume it to be isentropic since it is an ideal cycle analysis. So 1-2-2- is isentropic deceleration. And once again, 2-2-3 is isentropic compression. Okay, and from this, the output of your fan will be, fan only will be given as input to your compressor. So you could say the station number 3, the flow property at station number 3 will be equal to flow property at station number 2. Okay, and 3-2-7-, it is a nozzle for your secondary flow or bypass flow, because the cold flow, bypass flow, we don't do any combustion, we just simply accelerate it through the nozzle. Okay, so there we mainly depends on thrust due to the mass flow rate rather than the velocity difference. Okay, and next is 2-2-3, which is compressor, which is same as that of our turbojet engine. We will have isentropic compression, and then 3-2-4, which is combustion chamber, we will have the isobaric heat addition, and then 4-2-5, which is turbine, once again isentropic expansion, and 5-2-6, we will have afterburner, may or may not have the afterburner. That depends on the engine or depends on our condition, whether sometime we may operate the afterburner. If you are going to operate the afterburner, the property at 5 will be different than property at 6. If there are no afterburner, the property at 5 and property at 6 will be same. And 6-7 is basically it is a nozzle. Once again, we have the isentropic expansion. Okay, these are all the station numbers we know. Now, what we have to do? There will be a number of design parameters will be given. For the design parameters, we have to find out what is the thrust this particular nozzle, engine is going to produce. Once we found the thrust, we can find the, for the given conditions, and this much amount of thrust is produced by having this much amount of performance parameters like propulsive efficiency, thermal efficiency, overall efficiency, and then you are a thrust-specific fuel consumption. Okay. So, this we have already seen. Okay. So, let us start with station number A21. So, what is the A? That is ambient condition that is going to be decided by at what altitude your aircraft is flying. So, that is going to be given whether your aircraft is flying at the sea level condition or at a certain altitude. So, irrespective of wherever it is going to fly, that will be given. So, from that you can find out what is your pressure and what is your temperature. This depends on entirely what altitude your aircraft is flying. And we know what is the Mach number my aircraft is going to fly. So, that also will be given. So, your flight parameters is given. And then, what all the other parameters will be given? Some of the design parameters and design limiting parameters will be given. What are the design parameters? The compressor pressure ratio pi c and the fan pressure ratio pi f. And the design limiting parameter, that is T04, temperature at the exit of our combustion chamber or inlet of your turbine will be given. So, for these parameters, now we have to do the cycle analysis. Okay. First component is our intake. So A21, which is basically outside. So you could say at station number 1, your T01 is going to be equal to 1 plus gamma minus 1 by 2 m square. So we can find out, we know what is TA and what Mach number your aircraft is flying. And we know what is the value of gamma. For air, it is 1.4. So, from that, you can find out what is the total temperature at the inlet of your intake. Similarly, you can use the isentropic relation to find out whole power gamma by gamma minus 1. So, from this, you can find out what is the flow total pressure at the inlet of our intake. So, now we know what is T01 and P01. At the intake, inlet of your intake. So, next we have to find out at the downstream of your intake, what is your pressure, total pressure and total temperature. Okay, for that we should know what type of process happening across your intake. So, that is we simply decelerate the incoming flow. Meaning is that we don't add any energy or we don't extract any energy or to be precise, we don't supply any work input or work output. So, the process we assume it is an isentropic deceleration. So, you could say your P02 will be equal to P01 because we don't supply any work. So, as long as we don't supply any work, what is going to happen? There won't be any change in your total pressure. Similarly, it is an isentropic process. Basically, it is reversible adiabatic. Adiabatic means Q is equal to 0. There is no heat transfer, meaning is that you are total temperature also will remain constant. So, you could say your T02 dash is equal to T01. Okay. So, from this we found at the exit of our intake, what is my flow property? That is total pressure P02, T02. That is, we already know what is T01 and P01, right? So, P02 dash is equal to P01, T02 dash is equal to T01. Okay. Next, what is the component we are having? Our fan. So, as I already mentioned, the fan pressure ratio will be given. So, what is your fan pressure ratio? What is the total pressure at the exit of fan divided by what is the total pressure at the inlet of our fan? So, pi f will be given. What I want is at the exit of my fan, what is my pressure? P03 dash is equal to pi f into P02 dash. Okay, pi f is given and P02 dash we already found for our intake. Okay, now what is happening across your fan? It is isentropic compression. Once again, we can make use of the isentropic relation to find out what is the temperature at the exit of our fan. Okay, so T03 dash by T02 dash is equal to P03 dash by P02 dash over gamma minus 1 by gamma. So P03 dash by P02 dash is basically pi f. So you can find your T03 dash is equal to T02 dash into pi f over gamma minus 1 by gamma. So, now we got what is P03 and what is T03 dash. Okay. So what is the next component? We are going to take the compressor, that is 3. So as I already mentioned, your 3 dash is going to be equal to 2. The property at 3 dash will be equal to property at 2. So your 3 dash is equal to 2 means we already know your what is the pressure at the inlet of our compressor. So for your compressor, what will be given? A design parameter, that is compression pressure ratio, will be given. Pi C is equal to P03 by P02. What I want is P03, that is going to be Pi C into P02. P02 is equal to P03 dash. From that you can find. And similarly, what is happening across your compressor? It is isentropic compression. Okay. So since it is an isentropic compression, we can make use of the isentropic relation. Same, your T03 by T02 is equal to P03 by P02 power gamma minus 1 by gamma. Okay, so from this you can find what is your T03. Now we found at the exit of our compressor what is the total pressure and total temperature. Next component is combustion chamber. Okay, what is happening across your combustion chamber? At the constant pressure, that is an isobaric heat addition, at constant pressure, we are going to add heat, or we do combustion. By doing the combustion, we are increasing the thermal energy of our fuel. Okay, so what I am going to do here is that we are going to make use of the energy balance equation. Okay, so why energy balance equation? Because we are trying to add energy to the cycle in the combustion chamber by burning fuel. So I am going to make use of the energy balance equation in the combustion chamber. Okay. So what is the energy balance equation? Energy at the exit of your combustion chamber will be equal to energy of the flow coming out of your compressor plus energy added in the combustion chamber. Okay, so m dot A plus m dot F into H04. This is the energy available at the exit of our combustion chamber, right? Why? Because mass flow rate of air plus mass flow rate of fuel. At the exit of your combustion chamber, the mass flow rate will be summation of mass flow rate of air plus how much amount of fuel we are adding in the combustion chamber is equal to energy of your flow entering inside your combustion chamber or leaving your compressor, that is going to be H03 into M dot A. Okay, plus M dot F into QR. This is the energy balance equation. Okay, you know your H is equal to CPT. So H naught you can write, CPT naught. So I can write, if I'm going to take m dot A as common here, m dot A 1 plus m dot F by m dot A CP T04 is equal to CP T03. If I'm going to take m dot A as common, you'll have plus m dot F by m dot A into QR. Okay, so if I am going to take CP also common, here it is going to be QR by CP. So this m dot a, CP will be cancelled out, means you will have 1 plus m dot F by m dot A, which I am going to define it as fuel air ratio F. 1 plus F into T04 is equal to T03 plus F into QR by CP. Okay. So, in this, we already know what is your T04, that is design limiting parameter. What will be the temperature of your flow entering your turbine, which will be already given. So, that means what I know T03, I know what is the value of F, I know what is your QR. We have to find out F, that is, for example, if I am going to say at the exit of my combustion chamber, my temperature is 2000 K, let's say. Okay. So, what is the meaning of this F is that to attain that 2000K, how much amount of fuel we have to burn in the combustion chamber? Or what should be the fuel air ratio? So, that's what we get from this equation. That is, you don't need to simplify this equation in terms of temperature ratio. We know all the values T04, T03, QR and CP. You just substitute, you will find what is the fuel air ratio for the given temperature or for achieving the temperature, certain level of temperature at the exit of your combustion chamber. Okay. So, after combustion chamber, what do we have? We have turbine. Okay. So, here only there is going to be a slight difference. Till then, the pressure whatever we have done is kind of similar to that of your turbojet. But in the turbine, there is going to be a slight difference because in the turbojet engine, whatever the work output delivered by your turbine is completely given to your compressor. Whereas in case of your turbofan, a portion of work will be given to the compressor and portion of work will be given to the fan. So, we have to split the work delivered by your turbine into two parts. And we have to equate it to one part will be equal to the work input given to the compressor. Another part will be equal to the work input given to your fan. Okay. So, our station number for your turbine is 4 to 5. I am just going to introduce one more number 4, 5 dash and 5. Okay. So, in our turbine, we have multiple stages. Okay. The flow comes out of your combustion chamber will have high pressure and high temperature, which is going to expose to the first few stages of your turbine. That first few stages we call it as the high pressure turbine. And later as it your flow passing through your turbine, what is going to happen to your pressure and temperature will be reduced. So, the later stages of our turbine we call it as the low pressure turbine. Okay. So, here why we call high pressure and low pressure turbine is that here that low pressure turbine will be used to rotate your fan. And high pressure turbine will be used to rotate your compressor. So, we can write the work output delivered by your low pressure turbine will be equal to work input given to the fan. Similarly, the work output delivered by your high pressure turbine will be equal to work input given to the compressor. Okay. So, let us say start with the high pressure turbine. Okay. So, for your high pressure turbine, let us say here, I am going to write instead of simple m dot a, we are going to use m dot ah and m dot ac. What is this m dot ah and what is this m dot ac is that one is mass flow rate through the cold section, another one is mass flow rate of air through the hot section. In sense, in the outer section, that is in the bypass flow, we don't do any combustion. So, that one we call it as the mass flow rate of air through the cold section. And m dot ah is mass flow rate through the hot section which is passing through the combustion chamber. Okay. Now, let us first write down the work input and work output. So, high pressure turbine work output will be given to the compressor. Okay. So, I am going to write down the work input and work output equation. So, m dot ah into Cp T04 minus T05 dash. This is the work output delivered by your high pressure turbine. Okay. Will be equal to work input given to your compressor. That is m dot ah Cp into T03 minus T02. Okay. Now, I am going to just simplify this equation to find out what do we don't know here? Only T05 dash we don't know. We know what is your, say for example, if I am going here m dot h and m dot h is common, it will be cancelled out. Sorry. M dot h plus m dot f. Okay. So, if I am going to take m dot h as common and cancel out, you will have 1 plus f into, okay, Cp will be cancelled out. T04 minus T05 dash is equal to T03 minus T02. Okay. So, T04 minus T05 dash is equal to T03 minus T02 by 1 plus F. What I want is T05 dash is going to be T04 minus T03 minus T02 divided by 1 plus F. So here we know T04, T03, T02 and F. So you can find out at the exit of your high pressure turbine, what is the temperature, total temperature. So once I get the total temperature by making use of the isentropic relation, because across your turbine, your process is isentropic. So we can make use of the isentropic relation to find out what is the pressure. Okay. So how I'll find out that, you know, P05 dash by P04 is equal to P05 dash by T04 power gamma by gamma minus 1. So in this, we know what is P05 dash, P04, T05 dash, T04. We don't know what is your P05 dash. Remaining all values we know. P04 into T05 dash by T04 power gamma by gamma minus 1. So from this, you can find out what is your P05 dash. So here, your P04, you could ask where we have found, because your P04 is equal to P03. Why? Because the process happening across your combustion chamber is isobaric. So that means there won't be any variation in the total pressure. So P03 will be equal to P04. Okay. So next one is low pressure turbine. As we already stated, the work output delivered by your low pressure turbine will be given as the work input to your fan. Okay, so we are going to write down the, once again, the work output equation, that is m dot ah plus m dot f into Cp T05 dash minus T05 will be equal to m dot ac, because mass rate of air through the cold section, into Cp into T03 dash minus T02 dash. Okay. So, if I am going to take m dot ah as common from this, what I will have m dot ah, if I am going to take it as a common, I will have 1 plus m dot f by m dot ah, that is going to be f, and Cp, Cp will be cancelled out. You will have T05 dash minus T05 equal to, here you will have m dot ac by m dot ah, which I am going to write it as B bypass ratio. What is your bypass ratio? It is the mass flow rate of air through the cold section or bypass section divided by the mass flow rate through the core engine or hot section. So that's what we call it as the bypass ratio, B. B into T03 dash minus T02 dash. Okay. So here your B will be decided before your engine itself start design. We start designing, we will fix the bypass ratio. So you know B. You know what is T03 dash, T02 dash, T05 dash and F. From that you can find what is your T05. Okay. So once you find the T05, save. Once again your process is isentropic. You can make use of the isentropic relation to find out what is the total pressure at the exit of your low pressure turbine. From this equation you can find. Okay. So after your turbine, we have afterburner. Let us say in this case, there is no afterburner. So that means the temperature at the exit of your turbine will be equal to temperature at the inlet of your nozzle. That is T05 is equal to T06. Similarly, the pressure at the exit of your turbine will be equal to pressure at the inlet of your nozzle. And what is happening across your nozzle? Basically, it is an isentropic acceleration, and there we don't add any work input or we don't extract any work output. So basically, there won't be any change in your pressure. Similarly, it is an, since it is an isentropic process, there won't be any change in your temperature also. So you could say T06 equal to T05 is equal to T07, and P06 equal to P05 is equal to P07. Okay. So ultimately what we have to find out is that what is the velocity of the flow generated by your nozzle. So what is happening across your nozzle? We convert the pressure energy into kinetic energy. Okay. So from the available total pressure, how it has been converted into kinetic energy. So that's what we are going to see I'm going to write down the one dimension energy equation H naught is equal to H plus V square by 2 or UE square by 2. So if I'm going to write H naught 7 is equal to H7 plus UE square by 2. Okay. So here your H naught 7 is equal to H7, H06. Okay. What I want is velocity. UE square by 2 is equal to H naught 7 minus H7. So this H7 you can say that is static enthalpy of the environment to which your flow is being injected. So I can write it as UE square by 2 is equal to H naught is CP T07 minus CP T7. Instead of T7, I can write TA. Okay. So what I want is velocity UE is equal to 2 CP T07 minus TA. I'm going to take T07 as a common or T06. Both are same, T07 or T06. 2 CP T06 equal to 1 minus TA by T06. Okay, this is a UE, or you can write this equation in terms of P, like pressure ratio. So UE is equal to 2 CP T06 into 1 minus TA by T naught, or T by T naught you can write as P by P naught power gamma minus 1 by gamma. So PA by P06 power gamma minus 1 by gamma. So from this we know what is your T06, what is your CP, and what is your PA, and what is your P06 gamma. Everything we know. Okay. So from this you can find out what is the velocity of your flow generated by this particular nozzle. Okay. So similarly, same procedure we can use for the secondary nozzle also. Okay. From that you can find what is the velocity generated by your secondary nozzle. Now we know the general thrust equation. T is equal to m dot A into 1 plus F into UE minus U plus AE into P minus PE. Okay, let us say my engine is operating at design condition, or correctly expanded condition. Your PE will be equal to PA, so that term will become 0. You will have thrust equation is this. Okay, now if I am going to take a turbofan engine, there are two sources of this flow. One is hot flow, another one is a cold flow. So I can write the thrust generated is summation of thrust generated by the hot flow or core engine and thrust generated by your bypass flow. Okay. So I can write T is equal to m dot A H. This is a thrust generated by the hot, that is core engine. 1 plus F UE minus U plus what is the thrust generated by your cold flow? That is m dot A C UE effective minus. So UE effective we taken as the velocity generated by your secondary nozzle. So this is the thrust due to core flow. This is thrust due to the bypass flow. Now if I'm going to take m dot A H as common, m dot A H as common, I'll have 1 plus F UE minus U plus m dot AC by m dot AH, you will have V into UEF minus U. This is the thrust equation for a turbofan engine. Okay. This is the thrust equation for turbojet, and this is the thrust equation for your turbofan engine. Okay. So once you find the thrust, you can find out what is the performance parameters, like what is your propulsion efficiency, what is your thermal efficiency, what is your overall efficiency, and thrust to specific fuel consumption and all you can find. Okay, which is similar to that of your, the formula also same, similar to that of your turbojet equation. Okay, so with this, the cycle analysis of your ideal turbofan engine is completed. You have to remember, this is only applicable for unmixed twin spool turbofan engine. Okay. So if it is a mixed turbofan engine, means there it is going to be a different problem. Okay, so with this, I think I'll end this today's lecture. Okay.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.